EFRM's creative zone. So our guest today is someone who believes that advertising is the most interesting conversation a brand can have with consumer. So stoked to have Sagar Kapoor, Chief Creative Officer of Lowlandas. Sagar has spent over 15 years with Lowlandas and done some very iconic campaigns. I love his work for Lifebuoy, which has been one of the most renowned campaigns. They've been awarded for 5 years straight consistently among the best global campaigns. He's also been the global creative lead for the brand. Hi, Sagar. Great to have you with us today. How are you holding up amidst the lockdown?
Hi, Misbah. Thank you for having me. My pleasure, totally. Holding on, yeah. I mean, it's a new way of working, and we all have kind of gotten accustomed to it now, I believe, and we are finding newer ways to make it smoother, learning every day and kind of changing our ways every single day. So, yeah, it's been a journey.
So, I wanted to speak to you about a couple of things. One would be about the campaign you've done for Mumbai Police, which is amazing. First, I want to ask you that for an industry that relies so much on team chemistry, banter, and personal interactions, how has been your experience creating amidst, remote captivity?
So, Misbah, the deal is, it's been remote. Of course, it's been remote. And there's no, I, for one, do not deny the power of sitting together and working organically the way we've always worked. So, I can't say that the new, digital way of working is more effective. Probably not, but we have to make it as effective as possible. And hence, initially there were some times when, just staring at a screen and while you're brainstorming, you're just, at times you're not saying anything for, for minutes and for half an hour, for an hour at times, and you're just staring at each other, wondering, thinking, looking at various corners in your house like you would in your office. So it was unnerving initially. But yeah, like I said, we are all getting more and more used to it. And probably it has gotten a little faster in terms of thinking and timelines in terms of the output. It's just getting a little faster because it's also while you're on that Zoom call or the Teams call, you really want to contribute faster. Like I said, you can't just keep staring at a computer screen for for X amount of time. So yeah, it's been different. Of course, it's been different, but we are trying to keep it as organic as possible. We still have our small talks. We still have a occasional joke that happens while we are working. Those things are happening. The interactions are happening like they used to in office. But yeah, this is the new way we've adapted to it. Yeah.
So I want to firstly also congratulate you for your work for Mumbai Police. It's very nicely done, and I believe that the success of the campaign also got other police forces to adapt the idea for their respective states. So I want to know what was the genesis of that, and how did it all come together?
Sure. So Misbah, the Mumbai Police campaign actually right. It stemmed from a very very real problem, which was the sheer amount of force we have for the size of the city we live in. The city like Mumbai, I mean, the amount of force that it requires 24/7 on road, on street. So it was virtually impossible for the police to do it alone till the citizens didn't kick in, till the citizens didn't take it upon themselves to kind of help the police do whatever they had to do. And this was the stage of the first lockdown. It was new for everybody. We are not used to these kind of circumstances. And it was essential for people to understand why the police was doing what they were doing. And hence the idea came from saying everybody has to do a little bit of self-policing. You can't just expect the police to do their job. We have to get into a little bit of self-policing and self-discipline to help the police force do what they have to do, right? And which is what they are doing for us. So it stems from there, maybe Mumbai Police. And then when we spoke about it, there are always, even in a house, there'll always be a particular family member who will take on more responsibility in times like these, and who'll be a little more aware of things. So at times, even the kid of the house, like my nephew, he's 9 years old and he's probably the strictest among everybody. I mean, he's just kind of, he takes care of every little thing, whether you wash your hands, you sanitize your hands, don't get out of the house. So the idea came from that of self-policing, and the execution lended itself to saying there's always a family member. Even if one guy is about to slip, there'll be another member reminding that member not to do that, right? And which is where maybe Mumbai Police, main apne pati ko bahar nahi jaane dungi, main apne papa ko bahar nahi jaane dunga. So it was kept very simple, and the whole vodka became maybe Mumbai Police, which was the need of the hour to self-police and not only rely on a force that was already shot on people.
Right. So now that you're doing work from home, like ads from home and all that, and doing ads remotely, has the turnaround time reduced versus how much it would be when you would do it out of office?
See, it depends. Like I said, the thinking has become faster because we can't spend, you know, like we can't have two or three bouts in a day of thinking. So probably the thinking bit has become a bit faster, Ms. Ba. But on the production front, strangely, it requires a little more time because you have to, before your shoot day, there are a lot of prep days because nobody's going into anybody's houses. These are being happening at remote locations. So you have to take help of the people in that house to create every little thing you need for the shoot, you know, right from the art direction to the framing to the recce of the house and the location. So that requires a little bit more time because you have to probably spend more time pre compared to a shooting date where you would have landed at the shoot and things would have been ready because all the HODs, you know, were there together. So that process takes a little bit more time.
So how difficult is it for agencies to convince clients to continue engaging with these limited resources? Like, do you hear advertisers, clients telling you, renegotiating deals and telling you that the shoot will happen postponed, there are limited resources and all that? So how do you approach budget slash and limited resources when bringing an idea to life?
Yeah, so Ms. Bahasi, this was related to some other question I answered at some place, but it's probably more relevant here as well. At a larger macro level, now, what I've noticed is that both the marketeers and the advertising fraternity have adapted like seamlessly to this situation. Of course, there are challenges. Of course, there are, you know, new ways to think of every time. But they've taken the organic system of working over there onto this platform now. And we are trying to keep it as real as possible. You know, the meetings, the way we used to have feedback sessions, the way we used to have presentations. So I don't think it is about forcing a client or creating the need for the client to kind of advertise in this agent stage. It's more about for whom is it more relevant. If the situation is relevant for them, they will have to advertise and they will advertise. You know, they will come to you and they will need work get done. Of course, there are other opportunities where brands wouldn't think of having a COVID conversation, but one could think of a brand connect and have a very fresh conversation with the COVID angle in mind, right? But that said, a lot of regular brand advertising also has to go on. Not everything will be COVID related because that's not the only reality of our lives. We consume products for other reasons and not just this reality, right? This happens to affect a lot of things and impact a lot of things. But regular advertising and the relationship between the consumer and the brand, that has to go on and that does go on. So whichever brand needs to do that, that brand will you know, kick in and do that. So it's not more about creating that need or asking them to do stuff. Which, you know, they are organically doing, they need to do. And in terms of budgets, of course, now in terms of the production budgets, it has come down because when you work out of home, clearly the location cost goes down, the crew cost goes down. So I don't think that's as much of a problem. The HODs will still get their fees. There'll still be people, there'll still be a head of art. There'll still be a DOP who will be working remotely. There's still a director who works remotely and the agency also kind of attends the shoots. So it's not as much affecting the budgets because also the cost of production has come down along with that.
Right. Yeah. So, you know, there's a lot of, like most ads are done using the phone and all that, are shot using a mobile phone. And then there's a lot of UGC adoption and all that. But don't you think that we'll see a saturation soon?
See, it's not about the saturation because the what you're making also will define what you're making, right? I mean, it's not just the format that you're shooting in. What really matters is what are you going to make? If the conversation is interesting and is new and is relevant, it won't get kind of boring or choking, right? That's where we really need to focus. So, and we all keep reminding ourselves not to get bogged down about the execution at this point in time. You know, the execution will happen. We will figure out ways to do it. And every time we speak to a filmmaker or another HOD, that person has a new idea to kind of do something, you know, and we have, like I said, we are navigating and we are finding new ways to make it happen. If we get bogged down on the format of execution, the thinking will get deterred. And at this point, it's very important for the thinking to not get deterred and get dominated by the executional constraints. Of course, we can't think a lot of outdoors. We can't think that would be plain stupid to kind of think that way because that's not feasible, right? But it's not as restrictive. The stories will still happen. The conversations can still happen. So as of now, I'm not seeing that level of ceiling being hit where, you know, we are feeling choked or we are feeling bored of this constraint. And that's not happening at this point in time.
Right. So what are the new formats and opportunities that are cropping up in the lockdown scenario for creatives?
See, I to be very real, I wouldn't say opportunities. Like I said, we have to create some opportunities. There won't be much coming. We have to keep our standards going, our thinking going, not get affected by it, not be limited by the resource constraints. But what I've seen is happening is a lot of our people are directing, you know, stuff on their own, you know, because a lot of creative directors have chipped in and they've been directing their own stuff, because not every time would you have a budget or you have a, you know, kind of scenario where you can get the entire team involved. So that is happening a lot. The execution involvement has increased quite a lot, because like you said, UGC content as well. We depend a lot on footage as well at this point in time. So it's also about sourcing that footage and how people are getting involved in creating the visual world also for the communication. So the involvement in the literal execution has increased quite a lot.
We've seen lots and lots of communication based on the pandemic, based on coronavirus and all that through all the lockdown. So as we enter unlock one, how should this brand communication change? What is your message to brands and to agencies?
Misma, that's the macro one. See, it'll again depend on which brand needs to talk what at that point in time, you know. And what we have seen is, while of course there's a lot of talk about the pandemic, but if you just see deeper, one layer deeper, that also has evolved with the in phases, you know, as because it is a dynamic situation. It changes, you know, within days, it changes, right? But as the situation is evolving, so is the communication. If you notice, you know, brands have started talking of the next step of the COVID reality. You know, it's not just the original reality of just reminding people to keep washing their hands, not go out of the house. That happened. Now there's a next leg. Say, don't forget, in the life or context, I can tell you, if it's about saying it's still time to keep up with the regime. Don't forget, you know, this is not the time to stop doing this. And so on and so forth. Brands will have a newer thing to say as people are evolving emotionally through this pandemic. The next leg of communication will also have to evolve. And that's happening on most brands that we are working on, because it's a very unique situation that we are living this pandemic ourselves as well, right? It's not just that we are talking to somebody outside. So we know the realities of this. We know what we are emotionally feeling about it, right? And as that changes in our heads and hearts, even the work will evolve along with that. So that's happening at a great level, I can say.
Right. Perfect. Thank you so much for your time. It was amazing chatting with you, and thanks for giving us this story of how creativity actually shines through constraints. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.